Blackstone Audio presents Pride v. Prejudice by Joan Hess. This book is read by Meredith Mitchell. To Michael Morton, who survived 25 years in prison for a crime he did not commit. In 2013, the prosecutor was found guilty of failing to provide exculpatory evidence and survived 5 days in a county jail. 1. You have a better chance of getting on the space shuttle than you have of getting on a jury. Luann's pronouncement was accompanied by a noticeably snooty smile. She was looking sleek and tan after her annual safari to the beach, but that did not excuse her attitude. Had she not been my best friend, I might have been a wee bit annoyed. I opted to remain on a more cerebral plane. Do you suspect I'm non-compos mentis? I can assure you that I have all of my marbles in a box somewhere in the attic, I said. We were seated at a scarred picnic table in the beer garden across the street from my cherished book depot, working our way through a pitcher of beer on a lovely, lazy afternoon. The sky was blue, the breeze adequate to battle the last gasp of August heat. Students from Farber College were beginning to wander in, but most of the tables were unoccupied. I've never been convicted of a felony. I don't drool or fall asleep at inopportune moments. Perry Mason would embrace me as a juror. Aren't you overlooking the inescapable fact that you're married to the deputy chief of the Farberville Police Department? There is that, I admitted. And that you have a reputation for meddling in official investigations? Rumors of my interference have been greatly exaggerated. I was merely assisting the police on those rare occasions when they seemed to be straying in the wrong direction. I may have blushed slightly, as befitted my modest nature. Luann laughed until beer dribbled out of her mouth and her eyes watered. She finally gained control of herself and took the napkin I offered her. Oh, yes, you tiptoe among the suspects, dropping only the slyest comments, hovering unseen in the corner at the fateful moment when the perpetrator falls to his or her knees and bleats, "I did it!" The detectives scratch their heads and wonder about the identity of that Sherlockian wisp of haze. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I want to take a moment to thank you again for your willingness to make whatever sacrifices are necessary in order to serve on our jury. It is vital to our system in this great country that citizens such as yourselves participate in the dispensation of justice. Prosecuting Attorney Edwin Wessel, as he'd introduced himself to us, leaned forward to emphasize his sincerity. He was short and lean, with petrified dark hair, an expensive suit, and large, somewhat yellowed teeth. Unfortunately, they matched his complexion, which resembled a cheese pizza flanked by 2 tomato slices for ears. After sucking in a breath, he resumed telling us how we represented all things true and good in the past and present, and would have the honor of doing so in the future. I suppose I should have been flattered to be epitomized as a flag-waving patriot, but I was mostly hungry. The day had begun well before the unreasonable hour of 9 o'clock when we'd been told to arrive at the courthouse. I'd wasted too much time trying to decide what a dedicated member of a jury would wear to do more than slurp a cup of coffee in the car. The next 7 hours had been a series of forays in and out of the courtroom. We'd met Judge Lucille Priestley, a busty, middle-aged woman with an emphatic chin and hooded eyes. The assistant prosecutor, a twitchy young woman, had given us a startled look before burying her nose in stacks of folders. The defendant's attorney, a pudgy man with bristly blonde hair and rosy cheeks, who might have gone to law school with the assistant prosecutor, seemed even less enthusiastic to acknowledge us, although he had admitted his name was Evan Toffel. The defendant had managed a weak smile. Her name, we'd been told, was Sarah Swift, and she was charged with first-degree homicide. She wore a white blouse, and her long gray hair was loosely pinned in a bun. Her expression was more suicidal than homicidal. Prosecutor Wessel finally ran out of platitudes and consulted briefly with his assistant. As I'm sure you all know from watching television, the next process is what is called voir dire. I'm going to ask you a few questions, after which my colleague will do the same. Juror number 7, I believe you noted on the questionnaire that you were detained for shoplifting. This perked me up. Number 7 was the only one among us who had dressed for tea with the Queen. Her very high heels had clattered like a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.